Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Aren't we glad there was rain today? Good thing, isn't it? And the temperature is warm enough, so that's a very good thing. We are going to sing two beautiful praise songs, More Precious Than Silver and Come, Come, Everybody Worship, to get us going this morning. So if you'd stand as you're able, and we'll join in singing those two beautiful praise songs.
Worship God always.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. Please be seated.
Please join me in the call to worship. God's glory is pouring forth from the heavens.
Earth and all receives their news with great joy.
The promise is sure and true that Jesus has come to show us the best ways to serve God.
By serving and caring for others, we truly serve God.
Come, let us prepare ourselves for joyful service.
Lord, make us ready for great service in your name.
We are going to sing, O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing, which will be found in your hymnal on page 57.
Let us pray. You gather us from our separate lives, great God, to hear your word and respond to your revealing. You have appointed us for the work of your church. We seek your guidance, your wisdom, your way. Help us to perceive and understand your law, and then to follow you faithfully as your people. Bind us together with you in worship and transform us from distinct persons into the body of Christ. Alive with your spirit in this place. Amen. Let us now share our joys and our concerns. Thank you for that report. We'll continue to keep Dolores in our prayers.
Miss Emma had an exciting week this week. She got second in her class spelling bee, and then she was one of the teens selected for Invention Convention. So Wednesday was a big day.
That's good news. Congratulations, Emma. We're proud of you. Thank you for sharing that. While you're thinking, do we have any birthdays this week to celebrate? Any birthdays? No birthdays? I do have just a few announcements, but just keep thinking if you have something you'd like to share. Today I invite you to our adult Sunday school class following Koinonia. I had been doing a course on Advent study, but that has ended, of course, and it's not quite time for Lent. I'll be beginning a Lenten session on February 17th. That's the first Sunday in Lent. But the weeks in between, I am doing, we're going to watch a documentary on immigration and human trafficking. It's very good. It was shown on television maybe a year ago. Some of you might have saw it. It's called Lives for Sale. So we will watch a half an hour of the documentary this morning and then discuss it in the other half next week. So just inviting you to that time. It'll be for just a couple weeks. Also, for our prayer concerns, if you would include Alyssa, who is Tammy, and Dana's daughter, who's expecting the twins, if you'll just keep her and her family and her babies in your prayers, please. A reminder, too, that today is Human Relations Day, and I will let you read in the little envelope inside. It says how that offering's used, but to help reach out to communities in different ways that have needs. So we will take that offering in the baskets before we take our regular offering today. Any other joys or concerns? Dave Ramsey is also starting February 18th, so call the church if you'd like to be a part of those classes. Thank you, Merlin. Let us bow our heads now for a time of silent prayer. Dear gracious God, we thank you for this day you have blessed us with. Help us to use this day to your glory. We praise you for your love that is never ending. We praise you for the grace you offer to all of your children. May we be open to the moving of your spirit. May we open our hearts to you and to the people around us. If we are afraid, God, give us courage. If we are indifferent, help us to hear your call to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Be with us as we leave this sacred place to go out into the world. Give us your hope and your peace in a troubled world. Help us to trust in you and your plan to redeem the world. We remember all those who are in need of your healing touch. Especially we pray for Alyssa and her little babies and their family. Pray for Rita and Nancy, Sandy, Eileen, Dolores, Max. We remember all of our soldiers and their families, God, those folks that are in the nursing home or homebound and not able to be with us today. We continue to pray for all the people of Newtown, God. We lift all these prayers up to you today, trusting in your goodness and grace in our lives and in the lives of the people we love. We thank you for your constant presence with us. Help us to be faithful to you. Pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Please join with me in praying our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Selection for us this morning.
Oh.
Thank you, choir, for your beautiful music. Would the children please come up? Thank you, Viva. Morning. Good morning. How's everybody today? Are you good? I'm glad. I've got a lot of stuff today, don't I? Hope I can keep track of it. Hope I can find what I need when I need it. I have a lot of stuff today. Well, you know what? There is. What is this? It's a Bible. And this is a, looks a little different than the one in the pews because it's called the Young Reader's Bible, so it has lots of neat pictures. I wondered if you know what book has sold the most copies in the whole world?
The Bible.
The Bible. Did you know that? It's the most popular book in the whole world. Did you know that? Isn't that pretty neat?
Yeah.
Sold the most copies. The Bible's a wonderful story. And you know what I call it? I think it's like the letter from God to all of you. Could you kind of see it that way? That it's a letter God has written to all of you? What he wants you to know? There's lots of wonderful, wonderful stories in the Bible. So today, I thought maybe we could act out a fun one. Would you like to do that?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to read it to you, and as I do it, you can do the actions, okay? This is a story about the walls of Jericho. Have you heard about this story?
Yeah. They watched the wall for 6 days, and on the seventh day, they blew the...
That's right. You have it? Well, you know what? I'm going to read it, so those of you that know it, it'll be a review, and those that don't, it will be something new. Okay, so, but you have to kind of make me a little promise, okay? Do you think you can do that? The priests blew the horns, and there were like seven priests, but we'll let you all be priests so you can all blow them. But when we're all done, you know what you have to do? I'll show you what you have to do. You have to drop the horns in this sack. Can you do that for me?
Yeah.
So you get to play with them while we're up here, but before you go back there, we'll put them in here, okay? All right, that sounds good to me. Okay, so here we go. I'll give everybody a horn. And then we'll talk about what we... Well, you know what? You know what? Before I... Yeah, you know what? I'm not sure that'll work out because we might have more colors than we want. But before we do the horns, I probably should tell you, we're going to march in place because we're not going to walk around circles. So we'll just stand up and march in place, okay? And then you have to do some yelling, but I'll kind of help you as we read it, okay? So... I'm not going to. All right, here's a gold one. There's plenty of them. Okay, and I'll get my other package out. Okay. Okay. Here's my other package. There's a. Okay. Who still needs one? Okay, all right. I should have said two. Shh. How about this? When I raise my hand, it means you have to take them out of your mouth. Can we follow that rule too?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you very much. That's a good rule. Okay. Oh, I got my hand up. Okay. All right. I am going to read you the story, and then we'll kind of do the action. So you'll blow the horns, and you'll get a march. Okay? Oh. Okay. And right back here, maybe we can put the... Would you set those down there on the floor? Just kind of, this is going to be the wall of Jericho, okay? We'll just I'll just stack them all on top, and then we'll just kind of just knock them over. You want to just put it on there for me? Will you do that, Cole? Just on top there, just stack it up like a wall. Okay.
I don't really know what that is.
That's the wall of Jericho. Yeah, I don't, well. Okay. You know what? Oh, my hand's back up. My hand's up. Okay, that's good enough. I think that's fine. Come back up here real quick. Don't touch it. Okay, hands up. Okay, here we go. Everybody stand up. Stand up. It's okay. It's okay. Stand up. Okay. Shh, hands up, you got to let me read it. Okay, here we go. The gates of Jericho were shut tight. No one went out or in. Then the angel of the Lord came to Joshua. What does God want to tell me? Joshua asked the angel, I have given you this city, was God's answer. Here's what you must do. March your army around the city. Do it once a day for 6 days. Okay, so stand up and start marching. And you can blow the horns for a few minutes. Okay, 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 now stop, stop. Okay, shh. Okay, shh. My hand's up. Okay, that was good. Now we're going to just say they did that for, oh, shh. They did that for how many days?
6 days.
They did that 6 days. Every day they went up and blew the horn and they marched around. Now on the seventh day, do you know what they did? They marched around the city, not one time, not two times, but
seven
times. So start marching. Okay, shh. Hands up, shh. Okay, and you know what else they did? They yelled, they shouted, and I don't know what they shouted, but I think we should shout, God saves. So right now, march and yell, God saves. One, two, three, God saves, okay? And then, you want to knock the walls down, Grady? And then the walls came tumbling down. Okay, now you can sit down. All right, everybody sit down. My hands up. Hands up. Hands up. Come sit over here, boys. Come over by me a little, okay? Okay. All right, that was good. Oh, excuse me. Okay, remember the rules. Oh. All right, good job. Yeah, one last blow. Okay. There you go. Whoa. Don't go away yet, guys. We're still talking a minute. Okay. Okay, I need everybody's horn. Okay, I still need, Eric, I need your horn. There you go, right here. Thank you very much. One last. Thank you. Okay, very good. Okay, come sit down by me real quick, okay? All right. So, was that kind of fun? Boys, come on over here. I want to tell you something. Come on over here. Well, you know why we did that? I know it was fun and it made a lot of noise, but you know what? That's what I want you to know about the Bible, that the Bible is fun. It really is. There's lots of wonderful stories, lots of fun things in the Bible, and lots of wonderful words from God. Lots of wonderful words from God saying how much he loves you. So will you remember that? That the Bible's a wonderful book, and I hope the older you get, you'll read it more and more. I hope you will always want to read the stories of the Bible, okay? Because they're wonderful stories to you. About how much God loves you. Okay, do you think we can bow our heads and pray the words? All right. Okay, and I'll take the block over here. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you. We'll just set him. Oh, he's bringing it over to me, aren't you? Thank you, JJ. Okay, good job. That's okay. Let's pray words after me. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to love. Reading the Bible. Amen. Thank you for coming up, guys. You did good. See you later.
Scripture lesson for today would be found in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, 5 through 6, 8 through 10. This will be found on your Pew Bible on page 571. By the seventh month, the people of Israel were all settled in their towns. On the first day of that month, they assembled in Jerusalem, in the square just inside the water gate. They asked Ezra, the priest and scholar of the law, which the Lord has given Israel through Moses, to get the book of the law. So Ezra brought it to the place where the people had gathered, men, women, and the children who were old enough to understand. There in the square by the gate, he read the law to them from dawn until noon. and they all listened attentively. As Ezra stood there on the platform high above the people, they all kept their eyes fixed on him. As soon as he opened the book, they all stood up. Ezra said, "Praise the Lord, the great God." They gave an oral translation of God's law and explained it so that the people could understand it. When the people heard what the law required, they were so moved that they began to cry. So Nehemiah, who was the governor, Ezra, the priest and scholar of the law, and the Levites who were explaining the law, told all the people, "This day is holy to the Lord your God, so you are not to mourn or cry. Now go home and have a feast. Share your food and wine with those who don't have enough. Today is holy to our Lord, so don't be sad. The joy that the Lord gives you will make you strong."
Please stand for the reading of the gospel lesson from the Gospel of Luke this morning, chapter 4, verses 14 through 21, Jesus beginning his work in Galilee. Then Jesus returned to Galilee, and the power of the Holy Spirit was with him. The news about him spread through all the territory. He taught in the synagogues and was praised by everyone. Then Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath he went as usual to the synagogue. He stood up and read the scriptures and was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has chosen me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and to set the free oppressed, and announce that the time has come when the Lord will save his people." Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. All the people in the synagogue had their eyes fixed on him as he said to them, "This passage of scripture has come true today as you heard it being read." This is God's good news. And if you'd remain standing as you're able, we'll join in singing "Wonderful Words of Life."
Thank you.
As the preacher was ending his sermon, he apologized to the congregation for the extended length of his sermon that morning. He explained by saying, "I didn't have a watch with me today." Somebody from the back of the church shouted, "Do you have a calendar?" Most of us have been there, right? I know I have, listening to a sermon that lasted too long. I remember a time when I was listening to a sermon, and I can't even remember well where, but I was really engaged with what the pastor was saying, and I was shaking my head, and I thought, oh, this is really good words to hear. But then the pastor kept going on and on and on, and as he continued, I got really more and more agitated, to be honest, and when he finally ended his message, long after I thought he should have, those good feelings I had about the message had been replaced with some not so good feelings. Studies in communication tell us that the average person has an attention span of about 20 minutes. After so long, our minds begin to wander. It's hard to stay focused on what the speaker is saying. And maybe at least some of that has to do with the information being presented. How relevant is the information to us? Is it something we really are into? Is the topic of interest to us? If it is, maybe we'll listen a little longer. In our Old Testament reading from Nehemiah that Andrew shared with you, the folks must have really been into what was being shared because the scriptures tell us they listened to what was being said from early morning until midday, which you could say would be about, what, maybe 6 hours? That's a long time. But to try and make some sense out of the fact that men, women, and children gathered together to listen for such a long time, I think it will be helpful to know what had been going on in those people's lives at that time. These are the people that had come from the exile in Babylon. Like some 70 years earlier, their beloved Jerusalem was destroyed, the temple, their homes, the crops were burned, and they are taken as captives to Babylon to live what they thought rest of their days out in this foreign land. Only a new king came to reign, and he believed that they should be released to return to their homeland, and that is what happened. To their credit, the Israelites realized that this blessing to be able to return home was really a blessing from God. They returned to their homeland, which again had virtually been destroyed by those who had taken them captive. So under the leadership of Nehemiah and Ezra, the people rebuild. They rebuild their homes and the temple and the walls. Our Nehemiah reading for today begins with the people gathering in the town square, and they're requesting that Ezra bring the scroll, which contained the first five books of the Bible, called the Book of Moses or the Torah. Obviously, a lot of them hadn't heard those words for a long time, and maybe some of them never that had been born while they were in Babylon. So Ezra did as the people asked, and for several hours, he read the scriptures to them, and those who studied the law kind of circulated among them, helping them to understand the words of God. You know, that got me to thinking, sometimes we wonder how much of the Bible we can take literally and how much we cannot. So that got me to thinking about how much of the first five books of the Bible could Ezra have actually read in that about 6 hours. Could he have read the scroll word for word, or did he kind of skip around and just choose certain scriptures to read out of those five books of the Bible? So I looked on a website that was called Bible Fun Facts, and I came across a fact that supposedly it would take someone 70 hours to read the Bible out loud in its entirety, all 66 books. So I set up a ratio, one of the few things I remember from algebra. If it takes 70 hours, you know, to read 66 books, how long does it take to read five books? And would you believe what the answer is? I was amazed. The answer was 5 hours and 20 minutes. So to me, it seems quite possible that Ezra could have read every word of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy to the Israelites in that time. For some of the people gathered there to hear the word spoken, it could have been, again, their first time to hear it. Some of the people, again, were born in Babylon. They had never heard the stories of their ancestors. Others might have forgotten what they had heard so long ago. So I'm just going to take a few minutes to think about what they are actually hearing. So just kind of put yourself in their place. from the book of Genesis, when they heard the reading, they would have heard about God creating the world and how Noah built an ark so he and his family could survive the flood. They would also heard of God's faithfulness to Abraham and Joseph. Exodus is a book about the horrible plagues, you know, were put in place because Pharaoh wouldn't let God's people go. So they would have heard about those. And then, of course, the dramatic departure when the Red Sea was opened up so the Israelites could cross. That would have all been in Exodus. Leviticus, I don't really know what to say about Leviticus. For most of us, it is a very hard read. The first several chapters are instructions as to how to properly offer various kinds of offerings to God, very detailed instructions that don't mean a lot to us today. Also, instructions as to what to eat and what not to eat are included in this book. But for the people of that time, the word shared from Leviticus would have had to have been like a real eye-opener. I can almost hear them talking amongst themselves saying, you know, I didn't know we were supposed to do that. Did you know that? No, I didn't know that. You know, they just didn't know some of the things that they hadn't been doing that God had called them to do. And others would be remembering saying, yes, we used to practice that. We used to do that. But we don't do it anymore. The book of Numbers is a record of the wanderings of the Israelites in the desert for 40 years because of their disobedience to God. And the final book of the Torah, Deuteronomy. As Deuteronomy was read, the people would hear the Ten Commandments again and the importance of loving God with all their heart, soul, and mind. I just want to share with you some words from Deuteronomy that they would have heard. And just think about how the Israelites who had forgotten God might have felt upon hearing the following words. The God that created them, gave them life, and who led them out of bondage. And they'd forgotten him. Hear these words. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses, on your gates. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Do what is right and good in the Lord's sight so that it may go well with you and you may go in and take over the good land the Lord promised you to your ancestors. In the future, when your son asks you, what is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws that the Lord your God has commanded you? Tell them, we were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Before our eyes, the Lord sent signs and wonders, great and terrible, on Egypt and Pharaoh and his whole household. But he brought us out from there to bring us in and give us the land he promised. And then it ends with saying, and if we are careful to obey all the law before the Lord our God as he had commanded us, that will be our righteousness. Can you imagine how they felt after hearing those words? So what was the people's response to hearing the word of God read and interpreted for them for what we would consider a very long time? Did they say, thank goodness that's done, that's a long time, or I'm never coming back here again? Or, well, for sure, my dinner is burned now. Or, what's that have to do with me anyway? Or, I gave up 6 hours of my day for this. Or in today's world, the response might be, I could have used this time to wait in line to purchase an iPhone 5 instead of being here. And that's true. I read in September of this last year when the iPhone 5 first came out, lots of people around the world stood in lines a lot longer than 6 hours. To purchase that iPhone. And to be honest, you know, I could shop a lot more than 6 hours and I wouldn't be bored at all. I could do that. So it's all about what we're willing to do for 6 hours, right? Well, actually, the scriptures tell us that people did not respond in any of the above ways. In fact, the scriptures tell us they cried. And they were not tears of joy. They were tears of sorrow, sadness, because they realized how far they had gotten away from their God. A God who loved them with a deep, abiding love and only wanted, really, their love in return. The reading of the Torah reminded them who they were. They were the children of a living God. By their disobedience and lack of desire to follow God's laws, they had alienated themselves from what I would call their source of life. They had cut themselves off from their Creator. Have you ever seen children? I used to remember when we used to go to the Shriner Circus in Des Moines with the young people. The teachers would have a long rope. Have you ever seen that? And they would hold on to the end, and the kids were all instructed to hang on to the rope, you know, and it'd go down the length of the children to protect them and tell them to hang on to that so they wouldn't get lost. All these children were connected to the one leader by hanging on to the rope. If a child let go of the rope, they risk getting lost or maybe even getting hurt. I think that's kind of what God's people in this story had done. Somewhere along the way of their journey with God, they let go of the rope, and they kind of wandered off. Maybe that's because they were tempted by what they saw along the way. You know, you're hanging on to this rope, and you see lots of good stuff off to the side, so you just let go so you can wander off in that direction. Or maybe it's because they really didn't think there's any danger, that, you know, they're just making up. We don't really need to stay connected to the teacher, stay connected to God. There aren't any dangers out there. So they let go to go look for themselves. But now the Israelites, through the hearing and interpretation of the scriptures, understand that God only wanted to love them and protect them. God wanted to save them from the misery they ended up experiencing when they chose to turn away from God. That is what a loving parent does, right? They try to protect their children out of love for them. And part of protecting someone you love often means asking them to listen to you, to trust you, and to obey you. I have heard the Bible referred to as a love story, a story about God's love for us. And I think that's a wonderful way to describe the Bible. But I also think it's a story of reconciliation. Throughout the Old and New Testaments, God has revealed his desire to be in relationship with all he created. And even when people turn away in the Old Testament, the New Testament, today, God continues to love us, to love them, and to make a way for us to come back to him continually. When Nehemiah and Ezra saw that the people were crying, they instructed them to stop. They were told to go and eat and celebrate and share what they had with the others who didn't have enough. And then they said, "For this day is holy to our Lord, and the joy of the Lord is your strength." When I read that they were told they'd wandered away from God and now they were back and realizing what they had done, they were feeling sad. But the people there said, "No, you know, it's a time to celebrate. You've come back to the Lord." It reminded me in the New Testament, if you remember the parable of the lost son, remember that? This son wanted his inheritance, so his father gave it to him, and he left home and he spent all of his inheritance, the Bible kind of says, on wine and women and just having a good old time. Finding himself homeless, he decided that humbly he would return home and seek his father's forgiveness. The scriptures tell us that his father saw him coming, and before he even got to the door of their home, the father ran and met him and hugged him and said, "You know, we're so glad you're home." And then he said, "Bring the fatted calf and kill it. We're going to eat and we're going to have a party because my lost son has returned." So can you kind of see the similarities? That's kind of what the Israelites and Nehemiah and Ezra were saying to these people, you know, "You're back home, we're going to party, we're going to celebrate, you've come back to God, this is a very good thing." Hearing the word of God is what convicted the Israelites of their sins, and hearing the word of God is what set the people free from their past and gave them new life and new hope. Before he went to Jerusalem, Nehemiah served the king as a cupbearer. That was his role. His job was to taste the wine before it was given to the king. And you know what that meant. If the wine was poisoned, then the cupbearer would die, and the king would know that he probably should not drink it. That was his job. I doubt, maybe there were, but I haven't read about any antidotes at that time that would save a person who had been poisoned. At least they probably wouldn't have them right there. I title my message for today, God's Antidote. I think we have to admit that in many ways this world is poisoned with sin. Certainly greed, violence, prejudice, and hate poison our world. But the good news that there is an antidote, and it is the word of God. You know, I really don't. I try to share with the children in a loud way. I don't know what else to say. About the importance of the scriptures, and that the Bible is just an unbelievable book, a gift to us. Again, I don't have any adequate words to use to convey the importance of becoming familiar with God's word. So I'm just going to put it this way. Let's say that you're a big fan of Shakespeare. In fact, let's say you are the president of the William Shakespeare's fan club. And there is one, because I looked online, and there is definitely a William Shakespeare fan club. You have seen some plays. He's written a few. You love the film Romeo and Juliet, starring Leonardo DiCaprio. But you have never really read much of what Shakespeare has written, at least nothing in its entirety. Now, doesn't that seem kind of odd? Kind of. If you love Shakespeare, wouldn't you want to read all of his works? Wouldn't you want to learn as much as you could about him for yourself? Well, you would think. But to be honest, Shakespeare can be a difficult read at times. His writings include words that are now obsolete. A fan of Shakespeare had a very good suggestion. She said, seek out the characters in Shakespeare's writings. Learn their stories. Understand their feelings and motivations. Isn't that a good idea? I think it is a good way to approach reading the Bible. Seek out the Bible characters like Joseph from the Old Testament and Zacchaeus from the New Testament. Learn their stories, understand their feelings and motivations, and learn how God interacts with the characters in the Bible. The Word of God is truly priceless. This is what the psalmist said. I think he says it best when he wrote, the words of God are more to be desired than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. A couple of weeks ago, I ended my message with a challenge. I challenged all of us, myself included, to take seriously the truth that each of us is a representative of Jesus Christ, and to let that truth shape our actions at home, at work, at school, and at play. Well, today I leave you with another challenge. I challenge you to get into the Word of God. If you already are, then I challenge you to go deeper. I firmly believe with the Word of God, there will never come a time when we will be able to say we've learned it all. Studying the Scriptures is a lifelong endeavor. In ending, I have words to share with you from an Old Testament book, Joshua. This is what he said about the Word of God. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. May it be so for us all. And all God's children said, Amen. Now time for the ushers to take our offering, and we will be taking the offering for Human Relations Day first. Let us pray. We dedicate these gifts to you, O Lord our God, for you are worthy of all glory, praise, and honor. You have given to your people beyond measure and saved us with an everlasting salvation. May the ends of the earth come to know that you alone are God and that your grace and mercy are from everlasting to everlasting. Amen. Thank you. Our closing hymn is Trees of the Field.
You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will ring forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. While you go out with joy. You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. While you go out with
Thank you for joining us for worship today. We ask that you stay for Koinonia. We invite you to have a time of fellowship together. Go in peace. May the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you for always. Amen.